There is a coachwhip snake down here in this bush. Right now it's just basking, and I'm going to see if I can get it out. As you can see, I was able to get our coachwhip. This is Masticophis flagellum piceus. Before I begin talking about this snake a little bit, I would like to apologize to the snake. As you can see here, it wasn't overly happy with me taking it out of its bush. I did mention that this is the subspecies piceus. To my understanding, we are in the intergrade zone between two subspecies, the other one being Masticophis flagellum cingulum, but this one is really unambiguous, not an intergrade at all, and this particular subspecies is called the red racer. Some are more pink than others. Some that you see, like the one that we have here, can be almost completely black, save the ventral side, which as you can tell is quite brightly colored, and this one has some speckling on its face, as you can tell. Both this red racer and the other subspecies I was talking about, which is the Sonoran coachwhip, undergo a substantial ontogenic color shift. The juveniles are a kind of straw color. Ironically, they're much easier to come by than these adults. Today we are in southern Arizona, and we are looking for a very special larva. And it's one that I've seen quite a few times before. It's fairly common, and it lives mostly in mesquites. But despite this, it's not very frequently encountered by people. Here in this velvet mesquite, we have our first Syssphinx hubbardi. This one right here. I've been watching it for almost a minute, and it looks like it's looking for a specific leaf to eat. As you might be able to tell, they are a little bit picky with which leaves they'll eat, and they don't always decimate an entire stem, although that is often the case. And this Hubbard's silk moth caterpillar is not as big as they can get, but their maximum size as a caterpillar is a period that only lasts a couple days, so a little bit difficult to come by. This one could put on almost a centimeter or so more. As you can already tell, this is quite a morphologically unique species of caterpillar. It has multiple things going on. Certainly one of the most noticeable are these scoli, or horns, that it has near the head, both yellow and purple, and it also has a scolus, much like a hornworm. Something that I've seen in very, very few caterpillars are these kinds of scales that they have on the cuticle, and what's special about these ones is that they're actually slightly reflective. They're like little mirrors. And lastly, while it's not as noticeable, their spiracles look a little bit interesting, very dark. The adults of this species, the moths, are not nearly as striking. They're typically dark gray with pink hind wings, but sometimes they're uniformly gray as well. And they're one of the most frequently encountered silk moths, or saturnids, that you can find in southern Arizona. These are quite widespread, being found throughout the southwest in the United States, and Mexico, mostly towards the north. And it looks like it did find the leaf that it was looking for. We have a grasshopper down here. This is Romalea eques. These are commonly known as the horse lubber grasshopper. They're one of three species of lubber grasshoppers that lives in the area. The other ones being the plains lubber grasshopper and the Chihuahuan lubber grasshopper. Of those three species, this is the only one that's macropterous, meaning that its wings are of normal size, but not all of these horse lubber grasshoppers are capable of flight. Speaking of flight, in this species, when they fly, it reveals their hind wings, and they're actually pink in this species. They're one of very few aposomatically colored grasshoppers in the region, but to what extent they're toxic, I'm not really sure. Like other species of grasshoppers that can be gregarious, some years you can see hundreds of these, and some years there are practically none at all. This year, I've only seen a few of them, including this one, and this is despite the fact that their food source, which is mainly mimosas, is quite common every year. Right here is the frass of a caterpillar, and up there is the caterpillar that produced this frass. It's actually quite high up, maybe 3 meters or so, so I'm gonna have to use my snake hook for this one. And there it is. It'll be a little bit difficult removing this one. This is Eacles oslari, sometimes known as Oslar's Eacles, and it is one of the largest caterpillars in Arizona. You can tell that this one is about 2 to 3 times as large as the first Syssphinx hubbardi that we saw. You can see that this caterpillar regurgitated. You might have noticed when I pulled down the branch that a projectile vomited towards me. This is because I shook the branch a little bit more than I meant to. and this is the caterpillar's main defense. This is the only species of Eacles that is found in Arizona, and it is restricted to the central borderlands. This, of course, means that much of its distribution is in Mexico, especially in Sonora. Much like Syssphinx species, these lay one egg per site, meaning that these larvae are solitary when they develop. Some silk moths, like Anisota species, will lay all of their eggs on one leaf. I haven't confirmed this, but it is possible that this caterpillar has the longest setae of any caterpillar species in all of Arizona. These are also unique among Arizona silk moths in the way that they have these blue spiracles, something that I haven't seen on many caterpillars in my life. We have our second Syssphinx hubbardi caterpillar in here. This one is quite a bit smaller than the last one that we saw. And I also found one over here. This one was a little bit easier to see. And since they don't have them side by side, it's difficult to compare the colors. But this one is quite a bit darker than the last one. The ever so slightly smaller one, the one that's darker, has horns that are fairly straight, but they are greenish and purple, much like the lighter instar caterpillars are. But the other one has straight horns that are blue and yellow. And this is a peculiar case of ontogeny, because neither the first couple of instars nor the last couple of instars possess this trait. So the blue is gained when these caterpillars are a mid-size, and then it's lost by the time they are full size. If you were wondering, the first instars of this species are practically colorless. They're a kind of beige. And the first kind of feature that you see on the juveniles that stays on the adult are the white markings. This might be a little bit far-fetched, but the fact that these two caterpillars are on the same plant in the same area, and they still look relatively different, despite being the same size, might mean that they didn't come from the same brood. And what might have happened here is that two different moths laid an egg on the same plant, and now we have two caterpillars that are coincidentally the same size. And by the way, the eggs of this species are a bright, almost sea-green color. We've been finding these caterpillars on these velvet mesquites. These also feed on acacias and the little leaf palo verde. Despite the fact that this species absolutely loves the little leaf palo verde, I have reason to believe that the blue palo verde is actually toxic to these caterpillars. If you look closely, there's a horned lizard resting down there on the ground. Chances are it'll stay still. Got it. Immediately, you might be able to tell that its eyes are swelling up. And this is actually a defense of these horned lizards. This one being Phrynosoma solare, by the way. And these are commonly known as the regal horned lizard. Its eyes are swelling because it actually has the ability to shoot blood from them. This is not going to happen unless I really stress it out, so we're not going to see it. And actually, I've never personally witnessed a Phrynosoma doing that. This blood that they shoot from their eyes is meant to be aimed at mucous membranes, namely the eyes and the mouth. And this blood, if I recall correctly, is supposed to be foul tasting or some kind of an irritant. Like we're seeing right now, very often these Phrynosoma stay very still when they've been captured. Even if I let it on the ground, there's a very good chance that it won't run away. At least in my experience, this is a species that's far more common at lower elevations. And at these lower elevations, for example, in areas with a lot of palo verde, they're active year-round. Part of what makes that possible, besides the warmer temperatures at lower elevation, is their diet. These feed primarily on harvester ants in the genus Pogonomyrmex, and these Pogonomyrmex forage for food on the ground year-round. This is some of the worst devastation I've seen of a mesquite out here. In fact, it's true for the entire bush. There's only a few complete leaves remaining on the entire thing. We can't be certain that this is done by Syssphinx hubbardi, but there's a very good chance that it is. Even though the shrub is looking a little bit sad right now, it will persist. Look at this spider here in this shrub. This is Peucetia viridans, this green spider. You might recognize this spider here. This is the green lynx spider. It's a fairly well-known species of spider in North America. In the United States, it lives in the southern half, but it's also found in pretty much the rest of North America below that line. It can also be found in the far north of South America. The genus that this spider belongs to, Peucetia, is one of those annoying ones that has weird congeners. This species is viridans, but there's also Peucetia viridis and viridana in the genus, which makes it a little bit confusing, especially because they mean the same thing, and the spiders don't look super different. Luckily, those ones don't live in the Americas like this one does. But there was definitely a lack of creativity when these spiders were named, because the genus only contains about 20 species or so. These are creating egg sacs at this time of the year, in late September. and they create these egg sacs on low-lying vegetation, which is where they would usually be found anyway. And this vegetation is about a meter or so off of the ground, usually. The kinds of plants that they're most often found on are things like thistles, paintbrushes, and other shorter flowering plants that attract the insects that they prey on. We have another Syssphinx hubbardi caterpillar down here. And this one is just about ready to pupate. I'll explain why that is in just a second here. But first, I want to point out that there's a bunch of caterpillar droppings on the ground here, a lot of them. And when we look up here at this mesquite, you can see evidence of a caterpillar eating the leaves. I spent a few minutes inspecting this tree and I couldn't find another caterpillar. So I think that is the one that was eating these leaves. But what's a little peculiar is usually these caterpillars are supposed to descend down the trunk and then make their way to the ground. The reason being that they'll pupate somewhere inside the ground, much like a Sphinx moth. But since this one was found directly over its feces, there is a chance that it fell, which is a little bit unusual because these caterpillars are somewhat fragile. But either way, our caterpillar here does seem to be ready to pupate. And the reason for this is because we can observe yet another ontogenic change that has occurred here with this individual. And that is the entire body has become more of a deep purple. There's also a transition in proportions where it's become a little bit chubbier. And lastly, you can see that its horns are folded down a little bit. They've also changed color slightly, and the horn on the rear has also flattened a little bit. It's when these caterpillars are wandering around, like this one, that they might be most frequently encountered by people, as they'll often be crossing trails and roads. And it is when they're at their most vulnerable, since crossing the paths of ants might result in their death. There is a Stagmomantis arizonensis in this mesquite tree. That's this one right here. Looks like this one is missing a part of its raptorial arm. This Stagmomantis is commonly known as the Arizona or bordered mantis, and it's the most common praying mantis species in the western United States. But if we include the east as well, this is still the second most common mantis species in the states, and has quite the distribution, going all the way through Mexico into Central America. Around this time of the year, during monsoon season, the males are pretty easy to encounter, as they're often attracted to lights at night. For me, this is often near my flashlight when I'm walking around in the hills. As you can see here, these do exhibit diematic behavior, which is why their hind wings, as opposed to the rest of their body, is colored differently. This coloration can be quite inconsistent. Some of them will have yellow hind wings, and some of them closer to orange. This display usually only occurs when an animal makes physical contact with it, though sometimes this is not the case. I have found that the easiest way to find these during the day is by searching opuntia cacti, or prickly pears, perhaps because they're often the same shade of green. Today is the first day I've ever proactively looked for these caterpillars, because usually I come by them just every so often, and I think that's why I was able to spot this super tiny one here. This one must be second or third instar, but there's definitely a lot of luck involved here as well, especially since it's starting to get dark. I'm actually using my light right now. Today we've been able to observe several sizes of these caterpillars. This is evidence of staggered generation cycles in one population, and it makes sense because this species is multivoltine. I believe individual moths only reproduce once in their lifetime, but what I'm getting at is that among the population regionally, between early spring and early autumn, there are new generations developing on a rolling basis. A lot of Saturnid species around here only have one or two generations in a year. Meanwhile, these could potentially have a dozen in the period that I just mentioned. Well, that is all of the Syssphinx hubbardi that we are going to see today. So I hope you enjoyed, and thank you for watching.